every Feldenkrais practitioner should understand. That's why it was so important for me and publish this book to translate it, to bring it to the entire world, because until now it was just in Hebrew. I say that this is the first Feldenkrais method. It's not, it's a self-defense, Jiu-Jitsu and self-defense method, but it's the first Feldenkrais method. Then there was the Feldenkrais method, the second Feldenkrais method that all of us use, but it started from here. The thing is that Moshe was first. He was the first one to write a self defense manual, self defense method, because it's a method, Moshe's method of self defense. Okay, he was the first to publish a method in Hebrew here in the land of Israel at that time in Tel Aviv. Okay, but he was always the first. Moshe was the first, not just with the book, with the movements, he was the first with the concept of instinctive response. He was the first. And whenever I meet people that do Israeli self-defense methods, yeah, I tell them, okay, and Moshe was the first. And he was always the first. He was the first to become the leader of judo in France. He was the first, okay? And he was the first to give us, to develop the Feldenkrais method. Yeah, sure, it was, Moshe was always the first. And this is the original book. Even the original photo. This is the original photo that Moshe took here in Tel Aviv. And from this photo, they made this photo for the book. Yeah, this is original photo. I even went to the name of the photo place that it was developed those days. And in the back of the photo is this dedication. It's to boys with kind of appreciation to, and I don't know who is this boys. But yeah, I guess it's someone, you know, in, this was written in 22 of October 1930. Yeah. The book formally was published in 1931, but Moshe, as he told in his interview later on, that when the book was published, he was already in Paris. But this book, somehow, I found it in a used bookshop, okay, in Tel Aviv. Yeah, and always I have it on my table, and many times I just open and I look and I find, oh, this thing I didn't pay attention. It's a small book, you see. Today, maybe even if a martial artist, a professional martial artist, will take this book and he said, oh, techniques are not really something so unique and not so special and so on, maybe people would say this. But we have to remember that Moshe did not have like a sensei like I have. I have a sensei in Japan, and I go to learn from him for many years, every year. Moshe didn't have someone like this. He had this young boy from Germany that came and taught some movements, and Moshe developed much more. And it's and that's why it's good for it's important for every practitioner to look at this work of Moshe, and not with the eyes of a martial artist, with the eyes of a Feldenkrais practitioner. Yeah. Because Moshe was went left to Paris. The book was out, but not many copies. Not many copies, and it was in libraries, and it people looked at it, but there was no really demand. Moshe was not here to kind of promote the book, to promote the movements, and so on. But after Moshe published the book, some people that were interested in self-defense looked at the book, and the next generation after Moshe was in 1940, the defense forces of then, the same Haganah, decided to build up a better system really for the Haganah people to practice. And then it was funny because there was another Moshe Hurwitz. He was the head of this team in 1940. And I was lucky to meet him. It was when I met him, he was already 90 years old. And he told me and even showed us, you know, that he took this book from the library, and this concept of Moshe of building the technique on top, the instinctive response, yeah, was a key concept of this. The second, let's say, Israeli martial art method that was called the kapap, face-to-face combat, okay? Krav panim el panim, kapap, yeah? And they understood that what they need to do, because Moshe said, I'm starting from the instinctive response, this is a concept. I mean, what you want, if you teach someone to defend himself, and Moshe, and he, like, if you remember, this was the problem with the Jiu-Jitsu in Moshe's time. Why did he say that he will develop a Jiu-Jitsu of his own? Because his friends in the Haganah, when they met the real situation, it was difficult for them to use the skill. And Moshe understood. And it's kind of a genius thinking. It's a simple, but a genius thing. Maybe genius thinking is simple. Look, at that time, people were busy. Yeah, and the problem was that they came, they met, they practiced their jiu-jitsu, and then they went to work to do whatever they do. Suddenly, they were called to the battlefield, and it was difficult to use the skill in the battlefield because the situation is different. There's a lot of pressure. People attack you in a way that they do not attack you when you are in the dojo and you practice. They attack you really. They want to. It's difficult. And Moshe understood that the problem is that people forgot the skill at this time, at this situation. They forgot the skill because they start thinking, oh, what I should do, what I will do, and so on. And that's why he came up with this idea to build the skill on top, the instinctive response. Meaning, if this is it, this is the way you practice, this is the way you learn when you come to this situation, and you will do the same thing, even if you, but now as you do the defense and you already you can move on to the, let's say, the skilled technique, okay? So it is very, very smart, I mean, wise way to take people that do not, they're not martial artists. They do not practice every day. They just do because they are in the Agana. They say, okay, do some, learn something, then go to do other things, and then come to fight. Come to the battlefield. Okay, so Moshe was very sensitive to the situation in the battlefield, to all the environment, and he said, okay, we cannot just go there because we know how to punch and we know how to kick, and it's not enough. There's something else. And so it's very, very deep and sensing the situation. Yeah, and Moshe knew what he needed to do to bring people to this kind of skill. So anyway, it went on to the Kapap and then the Krav Maga. Everybody is talking about the instinctive, the natural. In the Kapap, they call it natural response. In the Krav Maga, they call it instinctive response. And it's something that if someone has to go out to the battlefield, he has to be able to react to surprising attacks. And when he reacts to surprising attack, he will use his instinctive response first, and then go on to the techniques, the skill techniques. In the Jiu-Jitsu and Self Defense book, Moshe used this idea of practical advice. I'm giving you practical advice, but you see that Moshe, the practical, yeah, he was practical. He was involved in some. Fights and in some situation that he really had to see to you himself. He used those movements, and his friends used the movements, and he had this, because he had this mind of a genius already when he was young. It became a way to talk to people. Okay, and what we see, that also when he came to the judo, he had a chapter about practical judo, yeah. And when he did the book, the Hadaka Jimmy book, the practical unarmed combat, practical is Moshe's way, all the time, until even if we look later on when. If you look at the master moves, he talks about a good movement is a movement that assures your survival, your self-defense, yeah? And so practical, it goes all the way through the Feldenkrais method. It's kind of main concept of the Feldenkrais method to survive. It's nice, to improve all kind of movements or actions that we do, but we want to assure that our students, the people that learn from us, Feldenkrais, the people that learn from us, Feldenkrais, will take this improvement of the body, of the body manipulation, of the awareness, to their survival. Yeah, so this practical advice or practical use of the body is something that goes from this Jiu-Jitsu and self-defense book all the way up to his teaching when he was himself was a little older, but he came into all the time to judo and to fencing, and yeah. That's why I say that this is the first Feldenkrais method. It's not, it's a self-defense, Jiu-Jitsu and self-defense method, but it's the first Feldenkrais method. Then there was the Feldenkrais method, the second Feldenkrais method that all of us use, but it started from here. So the, it's important also, you know, in maybe a nostalgic way to look at Moshe, at the young Moshe, to understand his sensitivity, his matureness, his courage. It's not, you need someone very young man like Moshe that combines in his mind and body, call it elements but not he did it because he could do it. You see, he could do it, but he needed to be someone special. It's not someone, not everyone. I mean, think about this. If Moshe was not there, there was no Jiu-Jitsu and self-defense. Only Moshe could do it. Actually, every Feldenkrais practitioner should understand. That's why it was so important for me and publish this book to translate it, to bring it to the entire world, because until now it was just in Hebrew. You know, I say that I opened the book, this little book, and I look at it again and I say, wow, there's something here that you see the movements, Moshe's movements at that time for, let's say, Jiu-Jitsu and self-defense movements. But now when I look at the ATM lessons that Moshe developed, I say, wow, you know, this is the answer. Yeah, maybe then he didn't have the ATM lessons, so he taught in a certain way. But today it's very easy to teach some of those techniques, starting, like do kind of a reverse engineering. I don't know if you call it. You go from the ATM lesson, going back to the techniques. Yeah, and that's what I do. I do it for many years, and it's very powerful feeling. That you take we did this turn on the heels movement and the other movements, and bring it to the technique, to Moshe's movement at that time, in 1930. I think that those ATM lessons, they bring into our body the need for people to become better, and this is what is for me, you know, for me, and I know for everyone that is doing the method as a teacher or as a student, this is the way to become better. Doesn't matter what is your situation. Even today, I taught, I'm teaching Zoom, all kind. I taught today in the mindfulness club. I teach every week Feldenkrais ATM lesson. And, you know, people ask, they're not Feldenkrais practitioners and not Feldenkrais students, as we know. They do all kind of other things, mindfulness club. And suddenly they meet the body, their body, in a way they never had this, or for a long time, they didn't have those feeling of their body moving. And I get from them all kind of questions, you know, because it's surprising sometimes, you know, that you take an ATM lesson and suddenly things happen. You know, you start, suddenly you walk, you stand better, you walk better, you see better around you. Mm-hmm. You see, this is one thing, because in the method, Moshe always talk about manipulation and orientation. Orientation is something bigger than, you know, we are on the floor, we do the movements, it's very nice. But then, okay, what happened with the way you can look around? What happened with the way you sense yourself in the environment? And so it just starts on the ATM, but it should go on and to all everything that we do. And this is the thing, you know, to become better in everything that you do.